invite to formally kickstart the briefing. The briefing, we can ask questions by show of hands after. Your Excellency, the Governor of Bayelsa State, please put your hands together for him as a formally kickstart the briefing.
Thank you very much indeed. The Speaker and the Member of the House, Senator Ogola, and other dignitaries seated there, and since the unfortunate incidents of the 16th and 17th, I am aware that our candidate, Senator Diri, and the party chair and other stakeholders have been speaking and telling the whole country and the entire world about the charade that took place in our state, about the invasion of our state by the security forces of our country, about the dehumanization of our people, and how in majority of areas and places our people were denied their right to vote for a governor of their choice. I think the story is all out there that took place in Bayelsa on the 16th and 17th was not a democratic election. It was a military coup against our democracy. It was the height of conspiracy by the federal government and the security agencies, and with the umpire INEC colluding and enabling, in most cases, the subversion of the democratic rights of our people for the sole purpose of achieving a predetermined conclusion. I think that story is all out there. And I want to commend the peaceful people of Bayelsa. I know that our people have been in mourning. Forget the stage-managed scenes of what looks like a celebration in some rooms and compounds of the diaspora and so on and so forth. But in general, our people are in mourning. Our dignity has been invaded and ravaged with the complicity of the institutions which, by the law and the constitution, are there to give a good and credible and peaceful result. So today I'm here to lend my voice to all that has been said already. And it was so brazen, it has never been like this in this state before. I know that 2015 went through very tough times. There was brazen display of federal might, but at least it wasn't as bad as this. In this case, not only was the Nigerian army directed to move over and take over our state, not only did the police, who claimed that they had over 30,000 men and officers on ground, they were on ground looking the other way while people were being mowed down in Nembe, and no steps were taken, either to protect the people or to hold those who did that disorderly act to account. That was the first time that people were mowed down and killed, some ripped open in Nembe and thrown into the rivers without consequences, up to now no arrests. And we all know that Tripura Silva, with his cohorts, Kojo Sam and Gabriel Jonah in the Golan, they plotted and carried out that act, which actually was intended as an assassination, because they knew I was to go there to campaign that day. And so in this state, we are now at a stage where people use armed militia to attack a rally, innocent people who are attending a rally, and mow them down at will. And even when the governor of a state is billed to attend, and the security keeps quiet, because it was meant as an assassination, because they knew I was going there. And unfortunately, at the last count, we have about 12 dead and about 5 reports to me of people who are missing so far. And in various hospitals and clinics, we have about 70 people and machete cuts inflicted on them, unarmed people who were attending a rally, dancing and singing. That is the scenario we have in this state. That was before the election. And of course, that scared every normal human being. Voters did not have the courage. And yet, you saw the results that were turned in from Nembe. And INEC, which has invested so much resources, not taxpayers' money, as it is in other words, our oil money. INEC that has invested billions on this, never bothered about their processes, and accepted and collated 80-something thousand votes from Nembe, where no voting took place. There was no voting, there was no election in Nembe to generate 80-something thousand votes. Please, can you just 2-3 minutes show the slide of the APC members thumbprinting in Nembe? Oh no. Yes. Show it. Alright, if it is not clear, you will get it ready so that we have an idea of what we have. The clips where people were gathered together, core members with INEC materials held at gunpoint, and they were thumbprinting. They were thumbprinting. When the processes start, the world will know the results when the analysis, proper analysis, is done. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's be clear. What took place in Bayelsa was not an election. It was a carefully planned, federally executed operation. Are you there? Is it set? All right. This is, his name is Inuro Ipoki, an APC member working with the INEC officials. You can see him thumbprinting. Yes, thumbprinting one after the other, while the INEC officials are turning from one place to the other and is stamping. That's the kind of thing that took place in Nembe, all through. So there was no time that registered voters in Nembe lined up and voted their conscience and made a choice. And the same is to be said about Southern Region also. The speaker who is sitting here was the collecting officer, was our own agent, our own local government agent at the local government level. And war after war that was hijacked The cases were presented and there was understanding. It was clear that so many wars, the wars in the Niwari war, taken away, material taken away by hoodlums aided by security forces. Opuama war, taken away by hoodlums, armed hoodlums, with security forces. With all of them, all the other wars, most of them, hijacked by hoodlums and the militia, with the active connivance of security forces. And they were taken either to Ogbenbiri community or Olokopri community, the hometown of the APC candidate, protected by the Nigerian security officials. And that was where, those were the places they stayed and wrote and thumbprinted and wrote results and brought them for collation. And these cases were all, both the hijack and all that transpired, these incidents were reported to the local authorities, reported ultimately to INEC, and yes, INEC received and accepted results purporting to be products of this kind of exercise. And we have the clips, in most cases. We have all the clips. So, that is the kind of chara that took place in the name or likeness of an election. So we need to be very clear, my dear friends, and people of Bayelsa State. What happened here on the 16th and 17th was not an election. It was simply a federally planned, forcefully executed, forceful takeover of Bayelsa State for the APC in order to lay the foundation for making Nigeria a one-party state. And for those who may be gloating, for those who may think that the worst has happened, we want to be very clear that as Democrats, we believe in using the systems, the democratic systems and procedures, to challenge what has happened. Look at what happened in Ogbia. In Ogbia, there was no collation done in any of the RAC or world headquarters as stipulated. In most of the areas, at the conclusion of the vote, the soldiers came and heralded everybody, ordered every person that they were taking them to Ogbia town. And there they kept everybody, brought more soldiers, led by a lieutenant colonel. Where have you seen that happen? A lieutenant colonel from 6th Division, given the mandate to coordinate that military operation in Ogbia town. In Ogbia town, you had so many soldiers taking over the entire place and asking all PDP leaders to leave, to enable them replace pre-written results. The results that were announced for Ogbia are not real. There has been no time that the people of Ogbia, since this democracy, voted that way. Not even when a son of that local government was former president. In 2011 presidential election, Ogbia never voted that way. In 2015, when I was governor and presided over the coordination of the elections, the people of Ogbia never voted that way. So where did they generate all those votes from? What happened in reality was that Our democracy is at a stage now where you have two sets of results. You have one result sheet, set of six sheets, that every other person, they will go and distribute on election day. But the federally backed party and their officials have another set of result sheets already filled, figures predetermined, and they target where and where those ones will be executed. That's what happened. So the APC leaders in this election have access to predetermined figures and pre-filled result sheets. And they decided to effect that in three local government areas in our state. They did that for Southern Niger, claiming that they can justify it because their candidate is from there. Forgetting that 2015, when the APC leader, Chief Silva, ran against me, his running mate was Southern Niger. And yet he lost in almost all the wards. We have our speaker here from Southern Niger, the state chairman of our party from Southern Niger, the DG of campaign Southern Niger. All the four assembly seats in Southern Niger are occupied by the PDP. The chairman of the party of the council is PDP, with 17 councillors, and all key political leaders, except very few of them, went to the other side. So in world after world, the APC knew that there was no way they could win, or even if they won because of some little sentiments, that they knew that the figures were not going to be enough to guarantee victory. So they went there with pre-written result sheets in South Africa. They went with pre-written result sheets in order which they executed. They went with pre-written result sheets in Nembe to turn out the number of votes that they had predetermined that they were going to have. So, once again, ladies and gentlemen, I want us to be very clear that what has happened in Bayelsa is one of the most brazen acts of distortion of our democracy, a brazen rape of our democracy. And I want to use this medium to thank and appreciate the peaceful disposition that our people have displayed. I know a number of you have in anger asked me why I didn't sanction you to do any other thing that would have helped or protected yourselves. But as you all know me, I believe in the politics of ideas. I believe in politics of stability. I believe in peace. I believe in using the existing systems, rules, to fight for redress. And I have no doubt that I'm right. I know that the temptation, I know that the pain is serious and will last for a long time. But I want to, as I've been doing since 16th and 17th, use this opportunity to call on you all to continue to show restraint. Two wrongs do not make a right. And when you have a situation where all institutions of state which have the exercise of your democratic rights, if those are the ones that have now colluded with armed militia, with INEC, you can imagine that the result is foregone. The result, the outcome is foregone. And that's what they wanted. So I want to urge you all to continue that way. Don't resort to violence. Violence is not the solution. And For those of you who have seen me since then, I want to repeat to you publicly what I've been telling you all privately. That we cannot be Democrats and at the same time be raising and funding and arming armed militias. You all know how that politics of brigandage led this state to before we took over 2012. This state was a killing field, and working with our people, showing leadership and example, and raising the bar on the values of government that I've been doing for the past 8 years, close to 8 years now, you can see why, in spite of all these distractions and the strains and stresses, our state essentially continues to be stable and safe. In the past close to 8 years, power has not been used by me to terrorize and harass and injure the rights of anyone, not even the weakest. Rather, we have used state power and authority and resources for the public good. We are not right at all times. We can't claim we have solved all the problems. But this one thing you all know, that we came, we saw, we've made a difference, and that difference will be here for a long time. And that difference is not in terms of the number of schools we have built, which we have built more than any other government. So when some people are talking or doing things out of envy, I understand, and you understand. They could have done, but did not do. We have built more hospitals and health facilities, taking care of our people in a manner never before done. We have built more roads and bridges, connecting communities that people thought could not be connected. We have built peace and stability in our states. And we have taught the lesson that power at all times has to be used. Power and public resources must be used at all times for the good and for the development of our people. I believe that these are lessons that we should not regret. These are lessons that we commend any day to the younger generation, and appeal that the federal government should do more in the area of restraining armed militia that have taken over the electoral process in this state. Since 2015, election after election, we have witnessed several deaths. We have witnessed destruction of homes. We have returned back to those days of people exiling their brothers and sisters. A practice that I stopped when I became governor, and gave instructions to the security forces, engaged with the leaders, and escorted all those who were displaced from their communities right to Limbe and Brass. And I want to thank the hardworking, conscientious security officers who served in my first security council. The same people, some of those who have been driven away from Limbe and Brass, that my government, because of our policy, return back to those of are the same people now who are being supported by Tinubu Silva and his APC government, backed by the federal government and the security forces, to now drive away people. Senator Deby, who is the running mate of the APC, couldn't go home. His house is still vandalized. I had to direct security to take him to Basambi and supported the reconstruction of his home. The same thing for Benmore Smith, who could not go home, and his brother. I had to direct security to take them home. And these are the proactive and clear decisions and principles that we followed to return Bayelsa to normalcy. A normalcy that we all now enjoy. And in close to 8 years, not one opposition figure will say that my government harassed that my government intimidated, that my government sent armed troops to attack rallies. No. That was the norm under Tripoli Silva when he was hired as governor. Not even the presidential campaign trail of then candidate Buhari was fair. But in the last 8 years, we have moved our state beyond all of this. And I would like to congratulate all my elephants for this. Because while these physical developments are good, the overall enthronement of a stable, peaceful, and conducive atmosphere is the most important condition for development. Now that is under threat. That is under threat. But I just wish our people well, continue to pray for our state that we so love, and expect that as we move to the next phase of examining the process and of exploring the procedures and the mechanisms provided by the law and the constitution, but we shouldn't go outside, no matter the temptation. I want to use this opportunity again to call on all the youth leaders who have been raising concerns and issues, and all those who are grieved, to take it easy. I understand the pain. No one understands the danger this development has for your future more than me. With the hard work that I and my team, working day and night, have put in the last close to 8 years, I can see all of it endangered by what has happened. But the solution is not violence. The solution is not to do anything that will aggravate our already stable society. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me round up by saying what I said in my remarks when I went to vote, which is a call, firstly, to the federal government and the president of the country to take steps to protect all Nigerians, protect our people. We're not asking for anything more than that. If there are policemen, if there are soldiers here, let it be clear to everybody that people should do their jobs. Now the rigging, the massive distortion of our democratic system are taking place. I want to invite all security agencies to return back to their professional ways so that we can continue to preserve and secure our state and our people. I have a duty in the next 3 months still to continue to do that. This afternoon I will be inaugurating my transition committee, because I've now gone into transition mode of preparing the state for the first planned transition. Whatever the outcome of the judicial, so I call for patience, I call for understanding and tolerance. And once again, I remind all that on the state of the law, on the 16th, the APC did not have a validly nominated or qualified candidate to go into the polls. But we need the judiciary to do their job. I condemn the intemperate language, the unfortunate way and manner Chief Tripoli Silva referred to a judicial officer, who, by the way, is someone I've not even seen at all, and I don't need to see by my values. But it's not just an attack on that individual judicial officer, it's an affront on the entire judiciary, an affront on our democracy. These are the kind of brigands and outlaws that I have had to contend and protect our people against. On this note, ladies and gentlemen, I'm open to take some questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. We have heard from His Excellency of the people seated because of the cameraman standing. You can also stand while you raise your hand so we can identify you, please. Questions, please. Okay, I'm to the correspondent for VOA, please. Please step forward. Capture your appropriate things. Please step forward. Thank you.
Who is asking the question, please?
I've seen the hand for correspondent for Voice of America, VOA. Come this way, please.
APC governors visited former President Goodluck Jonathan's house. So, are you satisfied with all the action for this visit during the election?
Well, I saw the images on the social media. First of all, my reaction is that the former President Jonathan, who is a former leader of our country, remains a leader of our country, right? He's at liberty to receive dignitaries when they come into these states. He knows that I always encourage that. I always encourage when dignitaries visit me. I always call him to tell him people who have visited and also to say I've requested them to pay a costly call on him. He knows that that's what I have been doing with him. But in the context of all that is going on, I know that the insinuations out there are not misplaced. In the midst of all of it, what I think the APC leaders are doing is strategic. Maybe the former president is not seeing it that way, but I can see the strategic content in what they are doing, which is they came to Bayelsa to take his state and his people by force, willingly. This was not an election. They knew. And they are my colleagues and my friends also, the governor of Kebbi and the governor of Jigawa, they are both my colleagues and friends. They never called me. They never visited me. But being the former president, I don't think it was out of place, but the game the APC leaders are playing, not just with that visit, but with the comments they are making about him, APC, Oshomole, and Co. coming to the soil of Bayelsa to be praising President Jonathan. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Yeah? But the reason they are doing that, if the former president doesn't see it, then it's really sad. Is they have been laying the foundation for this gross violation of the democratic rights of his people. These ordinary people never voted. The votes they have them are false. His people, the people of Bayelsa State, who have stood with him all these years, too thick and thin. And I know that no politician has stood by him more than me in this state. And he is our leader, he is our Maoga any day. So, what they did is, because of what they planned, they had to systematically lay a foundation. First, to be celebrating a victory never ends. So, on the part of the APC, they are strategic. I can see the strategic context. And the APC themselves knows. Timothy Silva, who is the leader of APC, and they rely on the candidate, the purported governor-elect, knows that the former president is not the one that has contributed to the rigging. But what they have used the former president's image is firstly expand this notion of a disagreement to justify the allocation of figures, and then after the rigging to now go to him. In other words, they have done terrible things which they know are not defensible. So like Pontius Pilate, they are preparing a window by which they will wash off their hands strategically and put it at his doorstep, that he endorsed it, he sanctioned it, he legitimized it. That's the game they are playing. But on a general note, former president knows that I have always encouraged and advised that to focus on national and international. That's what we work for, and God raised them for us.